Ecclesiastes 4, 3 verse number 12. What we're going to do is give a text, and we're going to give, I think it's a three-pronged approach to the text. And we'll get the title, and then we'll go into it. I know we won't finish tonight, but we're just going to start it tonight. And then we'll go from there. All right? Grab you turn your Bibles to Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse number 12. I thank all those coming out tonight to the house of God, all those tuning into the broadcast. We appreciate you as well, especially the brother in prison. Keep going strong for God. Ecclesiastes chapter number 4, verse number 12.
And if one prevail against him.
Here he's teaching the power, amen, of how to overcome obstacles or challenges. He says, if one shall prevail against him, if one comes against a person and prevails, overcomes him. Come on, he's teaching a principle here. Come on.
Two shall withstand him.
Two
shall withstand him.
Shall withstand him. Come on.
And a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Go back up to verse number 9. Come on.
Two are better than one.
Two are better than one.
Because they have a good reward for their labor.
Because they have a good reward for their labor. Read.
For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow.
Come on.
But woe to him that is alone when he falls.
When you're going through something tough, woe to him that is alone. Read.
For he has not another to help him up.
For he has not another to help him up. All right, we're going to start a series on relationships, all right? Relationship, and we're going to hit some very salient points regarding healthy relationships and why relationships are so important. Here, the wisest man in the world began to give a premise on relationship, and let me just begin by saying that if you're going through life without a relationship with God, you're going to run into something sooner or later that you can't deal with. If you're going through life, it's designed for you to be in a relationship with God. Life is designed for you to be in a relationship with God. The fundamental aspect of those that reject God is the principle of pride.
Right.
It's not just a love for the world, or love for getting high, a love for premarital sex, a love for partying, putting dope in your body. No, 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 no. One of the greatest difficulties that people don't understand is when you reject a relationship with God, one of the critical aspects is pride. Right. You think, I can make it in this world by myself. I don't need God to help me. Well, let me tell you, friend, you look, my God, in a few years, few months, a few weeks, and you will see, my God, individuals trying to make it without God will end up eventually making a mess out of their lives.
That's right.
Individuals trying to make it without God will eventually, it's set up and designed that way, so you will eventually, my God, get so weighed down with life, get so weighed down with the burdens of the issues you brought in yourself, that you will humble yourself and say, God, I need some help.
Yes, sir.
God, I need to humble myself. And some people, you know what pride gets them? They will be going down, down, down. But instead of humbling themselves, they'll try harder, harder, and harder.
Right.
But don't you know sin is like quicksand? The harder you try to get out, the deeper you go. Themselves and saying, Lord, I think about the prodigal son, and we're going to preach on that in just a few moments, but not from the angle that we normally do. But the critical is, he said he had half of a rich man's lifetime accumulation. And in a few days, it said when he had spent all.
Wow.
So if you was to translate that to today, this man has slaves, servants, all this land, all this stuff. If you was to translate that today, he probably was a millionaire. So they split that in half, he probably had, let's say $500,000. In a few days, he went from $500,000 basically to broke. The thought came to me, why couldn't he see, once he was partying all his life and money away, why couldn't he say, once he had lost $100,000 in a few days, he said, I ain't gonna lose no more.
That's right.
Why when he lost half of the 250,000? Why didn't he come to see? Because pride.
That's right.
Pride will cause you to have to go all the way down before you reach your hand up to God to lift you out. Many times, individuals, their life gets so bewildered with all that, and that's one of the reasons I was able to get saved. I said, Lord,
come on.
I do not want you to have to help me get saved.
That's right. I'm sorry for all the sins I've ever committed. I'm sorry for all the things I've ever done. I'm humbling myself. That's why we get on our knees.
Yes.
I humble myself before you.
Yes.
Let you know I need you, God.
Yes.
I need you to save me. I need you to forgive me. I need you like a potter needed the clay. Fundamental relationships that we need is a relationship with God. We humble ourselves and say, that's why sometimes people say, why are there so many men in the church and not, so many women in the church and not as many men? Well, you know what? Men, sometimes it takes a great deal for them to humble themselves.
All right.
It's just to say, I remember I'm on the back wall, man, and the last thought came to me.
I already had
paid the price, wanted to get saved, was ready. And then the devil came and said, if you walk down there, everybody gonna know you ain't got it going on, that you couldn't do it as long, that you couldn't make it, that you had to need, you need God. I said, you know what, devil? It's the truth.
My Lord.
My God. Haven't made that decision. I'm going to tell you, the devil is dirt. Here, he was trying to hinder me from receiving the greatest inspiration, the greatest relationship. Hold on. See, you weak. You need God. You can make it. No. I'm a real man. This, that, and the other, but don't got nothing, my God, hold on for themselves. So here, one of the critical aspects is to obtain a relationship with God, and the devil will do all that he can to hinder a person from obtaining a relationship with God, and he'll do all that he can to cause a person to hinder that relationship they've established with God to get in between it. But we're going to talk about the power of relationships, and how they're so important for all of us on many levels with God, as a family, as a community, as a church family, on your jobs. If we get these points that we're going to cover in this series on relationship, it will help us not only make heaven, but it'll help us here on earth. All right? So he said here in Solomon that it was critically important that we understand that. Read that verse number 12 one more time.
And if one prevail against him.
If one shall prevail against him,
shall withstand him.
So if one comes against a person, two shall withstand him. And two will be able to hold him off. I want to read.
And a threefold cord is not quickly broken.
It was an older gentleman teaching his son before he died about the importance of staying together. And this older gentleman was trying to impregnate his son's mindset and psyche on how critically important it was for them to stay together. And so he said he took a bundle of sticks, bound them together, and he said, sons, break these sticks. And they took them, they tried to break them, they just took a bigger thing, tried to hit it, tried to break the bundle of sticks, and they couldn't break the bundle of sticks. So then he took the bundle and he pulled one stick out and he said, son, break this. And the son took it and they were able to snap it in half. And he was saying that together, the bundle was difficult to break.
You understand, my God, amen.
But by itself, I was able to snap the bundle. So he was there letting his sons know, no matter what you go through in life, stay together.
Right.
No matter what comes, what goes,
yes,
make sure you guys stay together.
Praise God.
He was letting them know how critically important it was for relationships to maintain their fervor and togetherness. Go over to Mark chapter 6, verse number 7, the power of relationships.
And he called unto him the 12.
Uh-huh.
And began to send them forth by two and two.
He sent the 12 out two by two. He said, don't go alone, but go together.
Yes, sir.
It will be a struggle when you get out there. Sometimes you'll get weary. Sometimes you may get furloughed or you may get tired. But if you got a partner to help you out, sometimes we'll be driving down the highway and we'll get tired, and I'll reach over and I tell my wife, I said, babe, I need you to stay up with me because I'll get tired. And if you stay up with me and you talk to me, and you'll be amazed. You get into a good conversation. Man, you get into a good conversation. Next thing you know, you're coming from Georgia or wherever you're at. You look up in Cincinnati, it's about right there. My God, after y'all get blown a little bit deeper, you look up and it says, up on Dayton. You look up a little bit further and says, welcome to Finley. You look up, my God, before you know it, says Toledo, right around the corner. You look up and it says a big old sign with a mitten, welcome to Michigan. You say, hold on, I'm loving Michigan. And you get on a little highway, you're going down a two-lane now. You look up and it says Blissville. My God, I mean, the best ride. You look up before too long and it says, what, 10 miles of Jackson. Now you're going to be like, you know what, you can sleep on, now I'm close enough. What happens, my God? What? Because you had somebody with you,
right.
You was able to go a little bit further than you could have gone alone. Go over to go over to Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 1.
Is that the truth? Praise God.
Amen. Praise God. Amen. Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 1. Ephesians 4, verse number 1.
I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord,
come on,
beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called.
Come on.
Forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity spirit in the bond of peace.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Here he said one of the critical parts about how important it is for the church to stay together. He said, endeavoring to keep the unity of the spirit and the bond of peace. Let me say this before we touch on the point there of endeavoring. The most powerful family is not the wealthiest family, is not the most educated family, is not the most beautiful physically family. It's not the family with the most people. The most powerful family that you'll see is a family that is close together. More than money, more than anything, the most critical thing that you can have is a family that's close together. Anything that a father or a mother can ever teach their children, nothing, no lesson is greater than to teach them that no matter what comes or goes, y'all
stay together. If you ever want to hurt a mother, if you ever want to hurt a father, you just let a family of children go through something in which the children are no longer together. If you ever want to tear a mother's heart out, might like a child may lose a job, a child may get sick, a child may go through a period of time in which they don't have much money. But my God, nothing will tear a mother's heart or a father's heart like two of the children that no longer will talk together. He said, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit. What? And we're going to talk in a little bit about how do you endeavor. It says endeavor. It takes effort to keep unity in relationships. Why? Because you have different personalities. You have different makeups. You have different perspectives. And if you don't put forth the effort, things will come between you that will cause the relationship not to be as close. And when that relationship is not as close as it should be, then there will be a weakness there and there will be division. Go over to Proverbs chapter 6, verse 14. Oh, we're going to get into it. Amen. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 14. Come on and read. The power of relationships.
Praise the Lord.
Poor is in his heart. He divideth mischief continually. He soweth discord.
Come on.
Therefore shall his calamity come suddenly. Suddenly shall he be broken without remedy.
Come on.
These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him. A proud look.
Come on.
A lying tongue.
Come on.
And hands that shed innocent blood.
Come on.
A heart that deviseth wicked imagination.
Come on, all these things are terrible. But what did he say the last for a read?
Feet that be swift and running to mischief.
Come on.
A false witness that speaketh lies.
He said lying on people. He said God hates that. Read.
And he that soweth discord among brothers.
He said one of the critical things that God, of all things God hates, he said he that does what?
Soweth discord.
He said because it affects togetherness.
Right.
He said one of the things that I hate of all the things in the world is he that soweth discord among the brothers.
Right,
now,
right.
You have to understand, we're going to get real deep just in a few moments tonight, but this will help us in marriages, this will help us in family, this will help us in fellowship, this will help us on our jobs, this will help us all over if we can establish healthy relationships and maintain them. He said, of all the things that I hate, he said, one of them is he that soweth discord. Why? Because unity and togetherness is so important to me. It brings so much that he that does that is something that I hate most, because the opposite of that is what I need most.
My God.
Come on.
My God.
It takes so much of me to bring, you know, he talked about bringing the Jews and the Gentiles together. Nothing on earth was able to produce that. He had to die on the cross to produce that.
Right.
He had to die on the cross to different backgrounds, different customs, different things. He said, but my blood is so powerful that I can bring the Jews and the Gentiles together as one to build my church. Now, if my blood took that to build it, anyone that would come and to prevent that, now he said, he that soweth. Now, mind you, and that's why you got to have discernment when it comes to relationships.
That's right.
It didn't say he that came and break, bam. It said he that soweth. To sow is to plant a seed and then come back and water it later.
That's right.
Then you plant another seed and you come back and you water and you watch it grow. He said, he that soweth discord, see, to sow it is a subtle move. It's not easily detected.
That's right.
But it'll be subtle. It will appear different than it really is. And many times, once it appears and you can sense that person is trying to come in between you and your husband, or this person, that person, this and the other, by the time it appears to you, The seeds has already been planted, but you didn't know they were planted. By the time they come to you in person and divulge what they're endeavoring to do, you're going to be more vulnerable because you didn't realize that they only would show their true stripes if they had already planted the seeds.
My Lord.
Say it again.
They wouldn't show you because they're going after a particular purpose. And in order for that purpose to run its course and to be effective, timing is important.
Right.
So therefore, with discord, you first got to sow. You got to sow a little here, a little there, plant something here, plant something there. So eventually, by the time, that's why you better have some discernment.
Yes. Right.
By the time you see it, many times it's too late.
Right.
So here we see that of all the things that are critically important are healthy relationships. But many times a woman will be on her job and her husband at home. How's that? But anyway. Anyway, praise God. Amen. Anyway, she'll be on her job and her husband's at home. And it'll be somebody, oh, how's your husband doing? Everything going good? Oh, yes, everything is going great. Oh, yes, you went to this vacation. Everything is great. Oh, wonderful. I got you. Yep, wonderful. She never read. How's everything going 3 months later? How's everything going? They say, yeah, how's it going? Well, you know. Huh?
Help, Lord.
Well, you know, life happens. Oh, yeah, I know, life happens, you know, this and that. Wow, but I tell you, I don't care if life did happen, somebody as wonderful as you are. Well, anyway, you know what, I'll get back
come
with you, I gotta go do this thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yep. See you later.
Come on.
Oh, I can't come out and just show you my stripes, what I'm trying to do in your relationship, but I gotta kind of sow something. Listen,
my God,
no matter how strong I come, I won't be effective until you and the person that got a good relationship has been diminished.
My God,
no matter how strong I come, no matter how strong my case is, it won't be effective until I first diminish the quality of your relationship. So I gotta wait until, and I gotta plant. See, the seeds are not for me and you relationship. The seeds is to break and to tear down the confidence you have in this relationship. The seeds is not about me and you. When I show you me and you, I'm going for the kill. The seeds is over here that I can break this up over here. So now when I let you know what I really intend to do, that over there is so broken, you can't withstand what I'm about to present.
Come on.
Good, brother.
My Lord. Oh, God.
He said, why did he hate it? Because he said, that is not an accident, but that's a calculated, deliberate effort.
That's right.
That's not something just happened to come about or just happened. No. That was a process, and it was calculated, and it's been in motion for a long time. But by the time you see it, it already been, if you roll back the curtains far enough, you will see there were seeds that were trying to be planted way over here.
Serious.
You gotta be sharp enough, and you gotta be a husbander, a gardener, that you pluck seeds out your garden that you realize shouldn't be there. As you're walking through your life and you're being discernment and you're praying and you're meditating, you better look and see, was there any seeds being planted today? That conversation, was that a seed? That over there, was that a seed? Sharp enough, many times, even in families, you'll find after mama die, something comes up.
Come on.
After daddy die,
come on,
something
come
comes
on.
Up. it wasn't the fact that he gave you the car and he gave me the older truck. No, that wasn't the issue. The issue was way over here.
My Lord, don't you see?
When I got a whooping for this, and it didn't, and you seem to have done the same thing, and you didn't get a whooping, you just got a punishment.
Come on.
Oh, I'm getting way ahead of myself.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So way over here, I seen something happen that I couldn't make sense of, and it didn't seem fair to me. So I got offended. Way over here, I got offended. Now, it didn't manifest itself until Mama died, until Dad died. But it didn't happen there. It happened way over here. Something happened that I got offended, and I didn't get that seed, oh Holy Ghost, plucked up out
of
my garden,
yes.
And now it's grown into a sequoia tree. Oh, we gonna preach tonight. Go over to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, verse number 11. The power of good relationships.
My Lord.
I tell couples, whenever I talk to couples, I say, man, listen, you draw a circle, and you put a dot in it, and you put two other dots. That's God, that's you, and that's her. And you don't let nobody else in that circle.
That's right.
My Lord.
Guard that circle. If y'all got to deal with stuff, y'all deal with it.
That's right.
If he's making you upset, don't you call 10 sisters in the church and tell them about all his stuff. Y'all get to, you don't call 10 brothers in the church and tell them how off your wife is, how this thing is. You better be careful because they may not have a good relationship and they may not be happy with your good relationship. So they have to see them.
Yes,
you're right, your brothers ain't about nothing anyway, and isn't it? Okay. You be careful, you fight it out.
Right.
And you better be real careful because she may not be fully sanctified, and she may find out that you ain't happy. I know I can kinda make him kinda happy. You want me to go there?
Go ahead.
I'm not talking about physical. Oh, I will preach tonight. Y'all two ain't getting along to the extent of the strength. You're not satisfying his emotional need. He see mess around and have an emotional affair on your husband. So how you doing? Good to see you. Oh yeah, oh man, you such a tremendous brother. What? I found out that you ain't as happy at home as you should be. So I'm not gonna touch him because that will be a blatant. But I'll get real emotional with him and make him feel real good. My goodness, I like your ways. Oh, my praise the Lord. You are tremendous. Can I take care? Oh, you better be careful if you ain't ready. Listen, y'all a little young right now, so y'all thinking this can't happen in the church of God. But you better be careful. You better go in that circle and work out your stuff together.
That's right.
Get this straight and play it in 10 years. All right, come on.
And he said, a certain man had two sons.
Come on.
And the younger of them said to his father,
yes.
Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. And there wasted his substance with riotous living.
It was a very sad, sad occasion. One of the saddest stories in the Bible. Two children growing up in the same home. Good father, beautiful father, loving father. You're going to see the characteristics of a loving father. And here, this young one got wind in his jaws and said, you're making me be in the house at night. My friends down the street don't gotta come in the house at night. You wanna know where I'm going, when I'm coming back, who with me? You checking, you smelling and sniffing me, seeing what I smell like, and this, that, and the other. You telling me girls and books don't mix. I can't have her coming over my house this time of night. You telling me I can't have no food. You telling me all this stuff. You wanna find out this, that, and the other. You just too good of a parent. But anyway, you just. So here, you know what? I want all that I got coming. I'm out of here. I'm packing my bag. I'm going to stay with my uncle. He gonna let me do what I want to do. He gonna let me stay up all night. If I want to have a girlfriend over, I can have her over. If I want to get try that little skinny cigarette, I can try that skinny cigarette. If I want that boy to take me here and I don't want to say what time I'm coming home, then I can do what I. If I don't want to eat no vegetables, I ain't got to eat no vegetables. McDonald's every day. I want to listen to Young Jeezy and Lil Wayne and all these other Drake and whoever else. I can listen. I ain't gonna listen to Church of God stuff. If I want to listen to watch rated R movies in my room, I can watch rated R movies in my room. All right, God, I ain't got to deal with it.
Don't get out,
you know,
bro.
I'm almost grown. I'm 14 years old. I ain't no little boy no more. Can't you see this hair on my chest a little bit? Whistling at me. Mama, I probably get more whistles than you get. You know what? I brought you in this world.
Hello.
Don't make me go to
hell.
What are you doing?
You know what? And your parents mess when they get grown on you.
Yeah.
Oh, you know how your parents get grown? You say, I'm going to pack my stuff and go. They say, you know what? You go ahead and pack your stuff and go. You go back to your room and you get your shoes, your coat, your jacket, your TV player, your this, your that, your older. And she says, you know what? You want to leave, you can leave with your stuff. Take that CD back, your shoes, your underwear, your pants, your clothes. Take all that stuff back. You ain't bought a thing up in here. And you get real grown. And you say, I did. I bought these pants. I bought my own shoes. Oh, since you want to go technical and lawyer on you, then we're going to split these bills in half. I'm going to take that money back, and you're going to pay the consumer. Now you ain't got down to buy your little shoes. The prodigal son in today's message. All right, that's not our message. Sit down. Somebody needed. Somebody on the radio needed to hear that. Somebody here. All right, let's go ahead down to verse number 21. We want to get an element of the story that we normally don't preach on. Come on and read it.
And the son said unto him,
come on.
Father, I have sinned against heaven.
Come on.
And in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son.
Mm-hmm.
But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe,
mm-hmm,
and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fattest calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry.
It's just talking about the mercy of God. Woo! God, wonderful.
Yes, sir.
What a merciful. How could you not want to serve a God like that? You done messed up. You done wrong after you knew better. You did him wrong. And here he came and said, I'm restoring everything. I got you. It said he ran to him and kissed him. I love you, son. But let's look at this angle in regards to relationship. Keep going down. And this is a happy ending on that part. Read.
For this my son was dead,
uh-huh,
and is alive again.
Uh-huh.
He was lost and is found.
Come on.
And they began to be merry. Now this elder son was in the field.
Uh-oh.
And as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing.
Now this was the older son that was in the house. He did never go out and park. Come on.
And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father.
All that partying going on up in the house. What in the world is going on? What's all that noise? Servant, what's going on? He said, your brother's back. Your brother, he's back. The servant, no doubt, was he back. Your brother was back. A lot of times we look at this band with the good son and the bad son.
My Lord, yes.
Where's his good son at? Let's look, and I'm going to show you.
Help, Lord.
I want to read.
Good work, brother.
And thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he had received him safe and sound.
Uh-huh.
And he was angry and would not go in.
Your brother back. He was homeless, down out, locked up, messed up. Your brother back, bro.
Come on.
Yeah, bro. Read.
Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandments.
I never backslid. Read.
And yet thou never gavest me a kid.
Read.
That I might make merry with my friends.
Come on and read.
But as soon as this thy son was come,
come on,
which hath devoured thy living with harlots,
mm-hmm,
thou hast killed for him the fatted calf.
Read, had three abortions. Read.
And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine.
Mm-hmm.
It was meet that we should make merry and be glad.
Right.
For this thy brother was dead and is alive again and was lost.
And
his
father.
Praise God.
Okay, hold on one moment.
Jealousy.
Here we talk about relationships.
Right.
And we mentioned it earlier. One of the most critical killers of relationships is when people get offended.
Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
This is probably what we're going to get with this series tonight. There's only one point. There's going to be awesome points, but there'll also be some teachable moments, and this is one. One of the critical killers of good relationship is when people get offended.
My God.
Here this son was, and he hadn't done anything. The other son had left, wasted. He came back, and he got offended. And I'm gonna tell you, that's one of the most deadly poisons to relationships.
Yes, sir.
If somebody mess around and allows themselves to get offended, the relationship is almost irreparable. I'm gonna get into the word tonight, and we're gonna talk just for a few moments about how to be watchful that we don't get offended.
Amen.
And also how not to allow things that may offend you to run its course.
All right, my Lord.
Many relationships that are destroyed, like I said earlier, and I said I don't want to get ahead of myself, if you go back far enough, somewhere they were offended.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. In order for the devil to sever a solid relationship, many times some seeds, something had to happen in which they allowed something that was done to offend them. And they didn't sufficiently deal with it. Now, this was so deep that this brother went to the crack house, and it showed how the Holy Ghost dealt with him, and how he came back and went to the prostitution house, came back, and it was a great celebration. But when the Bible implemented the fact that this other son got offended, the story stops.
My Lord.
Oh, you didn't get that.
My Lord.
The story ends with the father trying to deal with an offended son. If it had been a good ending, he might have threw that in there too.
Yes.
But the story just stops.
My Lord.
The one that went out and messed up, it was more hope for the one that backslid,
yes,
and went out, got high, got drunk, got the wind women, wasted their lip with a rock. It was more hope for them. They had a happier ending than the one that stayed in the house, but God offended. We're talking about relationships.
Yes, sir.
You better not allow nothing to go so deep with you that you allow it to offend you. I'm gonna show you how you prevent that. But if you allow something that's up, and listen, I'm gonna tell you why offenses go so deep. Read verse number 29.
And he answering said to his father, Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgress I at any time thy commandments. And yet thou never gavest me a kid, that I might make merry with my friends.
Free.
But as soon as thy son was come, which had devoured thy living with harlots.
Oh, I'm going to tell you why offenses go so deep. Because
you put the facts together, right, and what you're saying is true.
All right.
Oh, right. Yeah. Right.
Look at the
Lord.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Oh, my Lord.
Wow.
What you said actually got some merit. You was done wrong.
Right.
You, the facts, if you waited in a court of law, it would actually come out on your side. Right. But even when the facts is absolutely in your corner, right, and what you did, you weren't done wrong, they did treat you wrong, it was respected person, it was this, that, and the other, you better have enough Holy Ghost down in your soul not to allow those seeds to penetrate your heart because you will end up eliminated and gone.
That's right.
In relationship that will absolutely, you're right, your husband did you wrong. That's why you better be careful who your counsel is.
That's right.
Oh Lord, thank you, Holy Ghost.
My Lord.
You better be careful who your counsel is.
That's right.
Because you will have facts, and somebody will come to you with a facts-given counseling session, and they will cause your offense to go deeper instead of telling you, I understand the fact, let that thing go. I listen to what you said. You may be right, but let it go. Get on your knees and give me 4 hands. Get that thing up to God. To you for the 4 hours, breaking down every fact, and then this happened, and that happened. I heard over here this situation happened, and they ain't dealing with it the same. And this time the other time. Oh, you better keep it up a whole
lot. God,
my God. So, listen, get that thing to God. Let God deal with it. Some grace down in your soul.
Yes,
allow my God to help you through it instead of going to somebody that's dealing with the facts.
That's right.
Somebody's gonna tell you this happened and that happened, and then he did, or your brother's boyfriend, he did touch you, and he left, and this thing happened. So now he's trying to get you to hate your mother. Your mother didn't know. Come on now. She shouldn't have been up there. Or your granddad should, or your mom should, your daddy should, he should have been there this day. You're right, the facts say he should have been there that day.
My God.
But you better get something down in your soul.
Amen.
That you don't allow situations that are right,
right,
to offend you.
Amen.
Because if they go too deep,
my God,
the Bible said go over to Psalms. Go over to Psalm 55:22.
Amen.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on and read Psalm 55:22. Healthy relationships. Come on and read.
Cast thy burden.
How to let offenses go. How do we let, Brother Lee, offenses go? I was offended. How do I let it go? Come on and read.
Cast thy burden upon the Lord.
Cast thy burden upon the Lord. Come on.
And he shall sustain thee.
And he shall sustain thee.
Praise God.
He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved.
Yes, sir.
Cast praise thy offense that's burdening you down upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer thy righteousness to be moved.
Praise God.
Okay. Something happened. Lord, you know what happened. I'm asking you to take this thing.
Amen.
Lord, I'm casting. Something happens. You don't deal with it. You don't cast it. You get counseled. And you figure it out. And it goes deeper. And it goes deeper. And see, once you are offended, everything that transpires in that relationship after the offense takes place is seen through the lens of an offended person.
Right.
So now dots will start connecting that never was intended to even connect.
Right.
stuff will start making sense, and the devil will make sure that you get involved and get information that will further your affinity.
Oh, of course.
And it's amazing, but he could even cause people at your job or people in your family or people wherever that have been offended to actually get together. And they can actually strengthen each other's offenses.
Help, Lord.
So now he said, cast thy care upon the Lord.
My God.
And he will do what?
Sustain thee.
He will sustain your experience.
Right.
Read.
He shall never suffer the righteous to be wounded.
As long as you do that, it don't matter what happens. I don't care how wrong they get you wrong. You cast it to God.
That's right.
No matter how they get you, you ain't moving. They may try to eliminate you, ain't moving.
All right.
You ain't moving. Hold on. And he shall never, what?
He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved.
Hold on. Well, I'm laboring for God. God has given me a burden, but they gonna kill my influence. They gonna kill my. I'm getting that thing to God.
That's right.
I'm keeping my spirit right.
That's right.
Amen. Well, they will never use you. I'm keeping my spirit right.
That's
amen.
Right.
I ain't taking my ball and going home.
That's right.
Amen. I'm still going forth for God. Suffer it never the righteous to be moved.
That's
now
right.
Let me show you why it's difficult to do this stuff.
Okay.
He said, cast thy burden upon the Lord.
All of
now, because
okay.
I got offended. I seen it. Acknowledged it. I got before God. Cast it. Okay.
Lord.
A little bit heavier. Yes, grab it. You got it? Okay. Better coordinate this. Better coordinate this. Okay.
Oh,
get to more effort. Okay. Now this thing that happened and it's been germinating for months and years. And I got counseled. Every time I got counseled, they told me and they festered and they caused it to fester and grow deeper instead of plucking it out. They caused it to go deep. So now I gotta figure out if I'm gonna cat.
It's too heavy. Lord, no.
It's too heavy. I prayed about it. I went and I prayed about it and God dealt with me on and I prayed about it, but then it allowed it to go too deep.
Good, brother.
So now I gotta live with it and I can make it. As long as no storm comes.
That's right.
As long as it's fair weather and everything is good, I can make it and I can carry this. But if any storm comes,
and I got to flee quickly,
and I'm carrying this, then whatever that storm is, that storm gonna catch me up. That's why he said over in Matthew 24 at the end time prophecy, woe unto him that be, woe unto her that be with child in that day. So if you got anything, I don't care what it is, weighing you down, it's gonna take everything to escape the destruction of Jerusalem. You got to run for your life as the world is coming to an end. It's gonna be so much stuff. If you got anything weighing you down, it's gonna catch you up in the storm. But if you can cast it to the Lord, if you can figure out some way to let it get back to God, say, God, I don't want this thing here. I don't want this, Lord. Have mercy. Cause this thing to leave me. God, please. Lord, I'm acknowledging. I'm being real. Take this thing out of me. I know she did me wrong, but I gotta see her clear. I'm not stuck with she did me. Why did it say that? Colossians chapter 3, verse number 12. Healthy relationships. Healthy relationships. Bad relationships will take more people out and cause more people to miss heaven than any crack house or any bottle of beer.
That's right.
Colossians 3, verse number 12.
Put on therefore, as the elect of God,
come on,
holy and beloved,
uh-huh,
bowels of mercy,
yes,
kindness.
Yes.
Humbleness of mind.
Come on. If you're going to make it, you got to put these things on, Reed.
Long suffering.
Come on.
Forbearing one another.
Come on.
And forgiving one another.
Yes.
If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do you be. So also do ye.
Read that verse one more time.
Forbearing one another.
Yes.
And forgiving one another.
He said if you're going to keep that relationship, you got to forbear. Everything going to be just like you like it. You got to forbear. Forbear one another. Come on. You know, it's sad that people get offended because some just don't go exactly like they want. Yes. Man, you offended by that? You got to make sure that you humble. Come on, forbear. The Bible said forbearing one another. I know, but she just make me sick. Every time she get up, every time that he do the dice, I just said, forbearing one another. Be careful that you don't allow that to offend you.
Amen.
You know, be careful. You won't have a pulpit to move. So careful. Come on and read.
If any man have a quarrel against any.
If anybody have a difference in their relationship, a fight, come on and read.
Even as Christ forgave you.
Come on.
So also do ye.
Hold on. He said, Christ said, your sins offended me.
My Lord. Yes, they did. Yes, they did.
Your sins offended me.
My God.
Your sins offended me.
Yes.
God said, your sins offended. Your sins hung my son on the cross.
My Lord. My Lord.
And here you're going to have an issue or something happening. Your husband did you wrong. This person did you wrong. This, that, and the other. And you can't have the audacity.
My Lord.
To forgive him. You can't have the audacity to let that thing go. Who is you? Let me show you what he's saying here. Going around talking about, well, this ain't the other, and I don't know. Who is you?
Right, man.
Don't you realize all the stuff and the offenses you caused God?
Yes.
And here you got the audacity to talk about, yep, and they did that, that. Roll back the curtains.
Yeah.
Every now and then. Let God show you what your lot used to be. The word forgive means to pardon for an offense committed.
My God. Praise God.
When you forgive someone, you pardon them for offending or something that they did that offended you. Amen. Forgiveness, my Lord, if no forgiveness, the relationship is further in jeopardy.
Yes.
Forgiveness is the foundation upon which breached relationships stand.
All right.
My Lord. And the reason why storms come and blow over some towers of relationships is because the foundation had cracks in it.
My Lord.
The foundation of relationships that had received a breach is forgiveness of the offense or what caused the breach to go on in the relationship in a superfluous way, superficial way, without dealing with the breach is to build up the tower, but the foundation got cracks in it. When a storm comes, it wasn't that that storm winds was so strong. It was that the foundation of that relationship already had cracks in it. Let me show you how forgiveness is the foundation of relationships that had breaches in it. Go back and think in your mind to when you got saved. The foundation, the Bible speaks about not laying the foundation of repentance from dead works. The foundation of our relationship with God is the day we got on our knees and repented, asked God to forgive us for the sins or the breaches or the offenses that we had committed. Repenting. So therefore you're building a tower or a relationship with a shoddy foundation. So when the first wind comes, your tower goes down. It's not because you didn't mean bricks. Wounded for our transgression. The Bible speaks about, amen, the ministry of reconciliation. Breaches, and God sent his son to die so that we can repent and cause the breach to be reconciled. If there is a relationship that you have with somebody and an offense takes place and you don't fundamentally deal with the offense, either by communication, getting an understanding, or casting that thing to God because it's beyond you dealing with, then the relationship from that moment will be built upon a shoddy foundation because you never dealt with the breach. So when the wind blows and the storms come, the tower comes down, but not because of the storm, because you will look, this storm wasn't even that big. It didn't even have no substance to it. How is this relationship being severed? It was years in the making. How did it just crumble? It wasn't a whole bunch in that storm to begin with. Well, it wasn't the storm. If you go back far enough, somewhere there was a crack in the foundation that never was dealt with. So now the relationship going forward is built on something shoddy, and the winds come and the storms blow. Other builders was in the same storm. Why did they fall? Because they actually had some offenses too, but they got those offenses dealt with and didn't allow them to go deep. They got those offenses and cast them to the Lord. And when the storm came, their foundation was strong enough. Don't you mess around and have something shady in your experience that you did something that you should have repented for, but you never fully repented. You kind of just went over it. You didn't fully deal with it to the extent you should have dealt with it. So now here comes something down here, and we find out we're sister so-and-so. We're brother so-and-so. Well, I heard something happen. Somebody said something. Well, I heard this, that, and that. No. Many times you go back far enough, something was in their experience that they didn't fully deal with. And they kept building on top of it. But the winds came, and that foundation caused that tower to fall over. In order to sustain healthy relationship, if there's ever an offense, 4 points. I'll just quote them. One, you have to give the benefit of the doubt. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, don't go there. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, it says, charity hopeth all things. You have to absolutely in your heart have some love for them and some love for God and say, hopefully they didn't mean it the way they did it. Hopefully I don't got all the facts lined up. Hopefully it didn't really, that wasn't their motive to do what they did. So I'm going to allow charity to cause me to give that thing that's trying to be an offense the benefit of the doubt, and I'm going to keep on being saved. Number two. Have to be willing, my Lord, oh Lord, Proverbs 19:11.
The discretion of a man deferreth his anger, and it is his glory to pass over a transgression.
Another rendition says, good sense makes one slow to anger, and it is his glory to overlook an offense.
That's right.
Good sense makes a person slow to anger. Every little thing you let that offend you, good sense will cause you not to easily be offended. I'm allowed something like this to disrupt my own tranquility and peace. Don't you realize when you accept an offense, you cause your own tranquility to be disrupted, not just theirs. Good sense will say, I'm not allowing that stuff. Don't even come to me with that. I ain't trying to, you ain't disrupting. I tell young couples all the time, couples in general, be careful to bring drama to your house.
Come on.
Good sense will cause you to say, take that drama somewhere else.
That's right.
Good sense sense will cause you to select friends and not drama-filled people.
All right.
Good sense will call every time you call somebody, they got some drama going on.
Yes.
Good sense will say, sis, let's pray. I'll get back with you because I got a lot of stuff I got to do with a lot of people I need to talk to about this stuff since you ain't receiving it. Good sense will cause one to be slow to be angry or offended.
Good.
And it is his glory to overlook an offense, meaning that those with glory in their lives, I've even seen those with power and glory.
Amen.
Something happened in the congregation.
Amen.
And my God, and I'm going to tell you, if anybody you need to pray that don't be offended,
yes,
it is your pastor.
Yes,
because so much stuff happens and they've invested so much. Think about it. You could have something, this, that, the other, somebody slightly do, but you done invested everything. You done gave your life in this person. You done you done pulled them out of this, and the slightest little thing, you thumped me on my head. The slightest little thing, and you don't even come talk to me about it.
Amen.
The slightest little thing, you come in just for 30 years, I done slept and half seen my children and done everything in the world just to stay up at night. This, that, and all my life for you. And the slightest thing come to you, and you just jump on board and just stomp on. But good sense. Thank God the pastor got good sense. Good sense. Let it go. Good sense will cause you, while it's up here, to cast that thing on the Lord and keep on loving.
My God.
So amen. In order to not be offended, you gotta have good sense. Alright. Okay, real quickly here, it said number three is, one is give the benefit of the doubt. Two is to have good sense. Basically, to overlook things that happen and have good sense regarding being slow to allowing that thing to become an offense. Number three is to reach out. To reach out. The Bible said, with all thy gettings, get an understanding. You'd be shocked how many times people have allowed offenses to grow by talking to everybody about how offended they were, except the person that they still want to talk to.
Right.
Except going to the person that they needed to talk to get an understanding.
That's right, man.
And they'll talk to air. So, but let me just say this, and this is real. It takes courage to face someone that offended you.
Amen.
It's way easier to talk about everybody else or to even run without ever even addressing it.
Yes.
It takes courage to go to somebody and say, sister, you offended me. So I want to get an understanding. Or this could have been offensive to me. I want to get an understanding. This thing. And many times you can get an understanding, and what they said is actually right. They might not have done it perfectly, but you understand where they were coming from. And you say, you know what, I got that. I can receive that. No problem at all. Other times, after they explain to you, it still don't make no sense. And that's when you got to go ahead and say, I'm not going to be easily offended. I got good sense. So that's how you just rub my, I understand what you did, but I got good sense. I'm good. Or if it's too heavy, I'm going to go ahead. I got an understanding. It still don't make sense. I'm going to cast this thing before it gets too heavy.
Amen.
And I'm going to go on about and maintain my righteousness.
Amen.
Number four. I'm sorry, that was number four. Is give it to God. And we broke that down about forgiveness and casting it all the way. You have to absolutely make sure that you don't do one of these. I gave it to him, but I'm still holding on to it. This is where it gets difficult. Hold this. I gave it to God, but I'm still holding on to it.
Praise God.
I can actually operate, and it feels lighter because He's holding it. It feels lighter, but when the storms come,
all right now,
Lord.
When the storms come and the winds blow,
amen.
That's when,
praise God,
it's going to become evident that although I gave it to God, I was still holding on to it.
My God.
And let me just say this, and we got to get out of here. Many times, how it gets this heavy is, like I said before, things happen, and from that point, you looking through the lens of an offended person. Yeah. Offenses never stay by themselves. They multiply.
That's right. Yeah.
So it will be one offense first. But because you're looking at it through a certain lens and you're getting insights in your ears from different perspectives, now about 25 things that person does has offended you. Now that thing is so heavy, my God, it's so heavy that you can't hardly deal with it, and the story just got to stop.
That's right.
The story just got to stop unless God himself can deliver. And why do you rarely see people deliver from offenses? It's because they actually have to look at the facts differently than the facts are. They have to look at it from their guilty perspective. Uh-huh. They got to look at it at how they allow the situation to go. When you look at it that way, you acknowledge it at the depth that it is. And God can't deliver you beyond what you acknowledge. So therefore, many times folk can't really acknowledge it as deep as it is because they're so focused on the person that offended them instead of acknowledging how deep they allowed that offense to go. And they need to apologize for allowing it to go that deep. So therefore, it's going to be difficult for them to ever get fully delivered because they have to humble themselves all the way down to the ground, not look at the facts, but look at their own way, their own situation, their own role that they played in it, how they allowed that thing to go so deep, and all the conversations and the communication that they had with others affecting them on how you felt, and you might have tainted other people. So now you got to see what you really could have done because of something that you felt was all on them. And you got to humble yourself and say, Lord, I'm acknowledging and I see myself. I'm asking you to forgive me. Yes. Forget what the facts say. I'm asking you to forgive me and to give me the humility that I need so I can have a healthy relationship with them again. May God bless you.
My God.
Humble, to be humble and down at the feet of the cross. Help us not to think of ourselves too highly than we are. Bless your word, dear God. Bless each one of us in this room that your word will go deep within our souls that we can utilize the things that were taught tonight when we need them as we're going in this journey called salvation. We love you from the depths of our heart, dear God. Bless your word. Bless the broadcast. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Real quickly, you pray. There was a man in the Bible, and make sure they record this as we close, and he was a great king, a general, and he had leprosy. And here, it was the worst disease that there was. And they said, is there a prophet in Israel that can help us and deliver us from this leprosy? And what ended up happening was they sent for Elijah. Elijah came and saw his condition. And he said, go wash in the Jordan and you will be healed. The man said, there's a river right over here and another river right over here. And these rivers are far cleaner than the Jordan. And it said he went away sorrowful. Here he was dealing with a life and death issue. But because he got offended, he was willing to go on and die. Offenses can go so deep, that's why it's hard to reason with somebody, that they will actually lose their family, actually lose a relationship they had for years, actually go away with leprosy, rather than humble themselves, get off of their horse, go over that dirty Jordan, whatever it is, bow down and wash and be clean.
Amen.
Be very watchful and careful and guard your heart with all diligence. Stay humble before God and say, Lord, please guard me.
Yes.
That I will not allow issues, people, and situations to offend me.
Amen.
I can't believe she said this. She didn't allow me to be in her way.
I can't believe they didn't give me no gift. I can't believe they didn't select me to sing my song. I can't believe they're gonna allow her to sing this and not me. I can't believe they didn't allow me to go forth. I'm better than he is. I can't believe. And they'll keep, he just allowed him to do it because that's his buddy. Or that's her buddy. That's her nephew. That's it.
Come on, come on. Very careful, Gordon.
If you ever allow offenses to go too deep, many times folk are more willing to allow the relationship to die.
Yes.
Before I humble myself and get it corrected. Lord, help us all to watch ourselves to not allow offenses to come and hinder our great relationship.
Amen.
Shall we stand?